I got, yeah. morning.
Good morning.
Wow, how great is it to be back in here today. This morning, Pastor James let us know he did the math and he figured out what the count is. It has been 60 weeks since we worshiped in this beautiful building that we call...
Amen.
But you know, for these last 60 weeks, we have not paused even for a moment in praising our God, in worshiping Him, and glorifying Him through song, through the hearing of His word. And praise God for the technology that we've had for this last year to be able to continue to do that and even have some form of fellowship, whether that be on Zoom or on Facebook or wherever it may be. To still connect and to still see each other and be with each other in some way. But how wonderful is it to have these wonderful, beautiful people back here singing with us this morning. Our choir and Tom is ready to lead them, and we're just going to have an amazing time of worship this morning. And you know, this last year, we were able to emphasize this thing that we've been saying, that we Christians have been saying for the last 2,000 years. That our God is not confined to four walls and a ceiling. Our God is not confined to just this place. And our worship of Him is not...
Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Great things He hath taught us, great things He hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him praise. hath done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great things he hath done.
Amen.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand.
All other ground
is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his
lovely face,
I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Amen.
Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul,
it is well. Should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate, and hath shed his own blood my soul. It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul,
it is well, it is well with my soul. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well.
It is well
with my soul.
With my soul. It is well.
It is well.
Be seated this morning.
Good morning, church. Welcome. If you wear glasses, you've been in a fog for the last year as well, right? The struggle is real. But hey, welcome to church. It's wonderful to see you. Welcome at home, and if you're at home, you may not feel the palpable emotion that is in this place this morning, but we need to be reminded this morning as well that it has been well for the past 60 weeks, because God is sovereign. He is on the throne. We don't worship an emotion or feeling, but we thank God for the gift of this building. We thank God for the gift of this gathering this morning. We thank God for the freedom that we have to worship. And we thank God that we are in a safer place than what we have been. And we pray for those areas in the world that are struggling big time, India, for example. But right now, we want to center ourselves on why we gather. We want to center ourselves on why we've gathered for the past year in different ways. And those are minor things, the ways we have gathered. The major thing is who we have gathered for. Amen? Now, we're going to go into a time of communion, which is a time to remember. It's a time to thank God for the gift of Jesus' death on the cross. And he paid for our sins. And if you're watching at home, I'm going to give you a moment in just a minute, so hang with me. And I'll give you time to get your communion elements from the kitchen, so don't go anywhere yet. In John 15, verse 4, Jesus said, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." So Jesus is the vine. You and I, we are the branches. We draw our life and our sustenance from Jesus. Through Jesus flows all that we need to grow and thrive in life. Communion is an opportunity to remember the connection that we have with our sustenance, and the incredible extent that the vine, that Jesus went to provide us branches the opportunity to connect, to thrive, and to grow in him. It's truly a privilege. So if you're at home, now's the time. I'm going to dismiss you to get your communion elements and come on back. And I want to encourage all of you here as well in the building just to take a moment, bow your heads in silent prayer before your God and abide in your sustenance. Confess your sins to God and thank him for the forgiveness and sustenance offered through Christ. So we'll just take a moment of silent prayer and then we'll partake together. Let's go to God. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take. And in the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's take. Father, we come before you. We confess that we are sinners who fall short of your glory. We thank you for the forgiveness that is found in Christ. And we thank you for the gift of the cross, the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. He is our sustenance. Lord, may we continue to take up our cross and follow Jesus. And I pray this in his wonderful name. And all God's people said, amen.
Good morning. My name is John, and I am the Special Projects Pastor here at Christ First, and I have a few announcements to share with you. First, we're excited to announce that our church is going to be hosting a Grief Share group. Grief Share is a friendly, caring group of people who will walk alongside you through one of life's most difficult experiences. You do not have to go through the grieving process alone. The group is going to meet Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. beginning this week, May 5th. There's a $10 charge to cover the cost of the workbook. And if you'd like more information on that, you may email griefshare@christ-first.org. We have a new sermon series coming up, Women of the Bible. Let's go ahead and watch a short video about that.
Miriam, Leah, Esther, Rachel. Did you know there are over 700 women mentioned in the Bible, and that over 100 of those biblical women are mentioned by name? According to one author, over 75 women in the Bible speak. The Shulamite woman, Naomi, and Hannah are amongst the 10 women who speak the most in the Bible. And Jesus' longest conversation, described in the Gospels, was with the Samaritan woman at the well. Many of the women in the Bible could be considered heroes, like Miriam, sister of Aaron and Moses, Rahab, who protected the two spies sent by Joshua to the city of Jericho, Ruth, the young widow devoted to her mother-in-law, and Esther, a Jewish queen who interceded for and prevented the extermination of her people. And of course, Mary, the mother of Jesus, who was described in the Gospel of Luke as you who are highly favored.
So that series begins next Sunday, May 9th, which is also Mother's Day. And speaking of Mother's Day, we will have a small gift for all women who attend one of the services next week. When you came in, you were given an invite card. That's not for you. Pray about it and see who God puts on your heart. Hand it out to family or friends to come to enjoy this series with us. When you exit today, we're going to ask that you go out this door, come in through that, exit this way. Someone will be at the door with more invite cards. If God puts it on your heart, I think you should put it on everyone's heart, to take several with you and give them out this week. Finally, I'd like you to look at the connection card. You've all should receive one of those. It is important that everyone fill one out. It's part of our COVID protocol that we keep track of everyone who is here today. So if you mark that you're a first-time guest, we will give a $5 donation to Operation Christmas Child in your behalf. It's a great place to put prayer and praise requests. Prayer request and praise reports. The prayer request can be marked confidential, then only the staff will see that and be praying for you. Otherwise, you've got a whole army of prayer warriors lifting your need up to God. And we'd love to hear what God is doing in your life. So please take a moment and share your praise reports. If you'd like to receive the e-news, which I think you all should, it's a fabulous vehicle, you can mark on here that you would like to receive the e-news and put down your email address. I encourage you to connect with us on Facebook and Instagram, and you can turn your card in later with your offering later in the service. So, as I said, it's important that everyone at least put their name on the card so we have a record who attended this morning. So we're going to take a moment right now and let you fill out your connection card. Thank you.
Thank you.
They're not real. They don't need water. As we get started, let's bow our heads in prayer. God, we come before you humbly. And Lord, we have been humbled over the past year, and we want to continue to be humbled because that's the heart stance you call us to be before a mighty, holy, sovereign, and powerful, and good, and gracious God. And so, Father, once again, we just want to thank you for the past 60 weeks. We want to thank you for the 60 weeks to come. We want to thank you for the next 30 minutes as we dig into your word and pray that you would speak to us in a mighty way as you always do. And Father, I pray that our hearts and our minds would be open to hear what you have to say to each and every one of us. I pray that we would humble ourselves in this moment to hear from you. God, I want to lift up just the tragedy that took place in Israel with the loss of so many people, so many young people, so many teenagers in this horrific, what seems to be just a chaotic accident. And we just pray for the families who are mourning and are hurting and are confused and just the clash of emotions this morning. And just bless and comfort them at this time. So God, speak to us in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. So as a reminder, we're a church that exists to equip every generation to reach their relational world for Christ. And as John said, take those invite cards for next Sunday, pass them out, invite somebody, invite somebodies, invite more than one person. We have a job to do. We have a temporary time on this planet, but we have an incredible mission. And so let's be about our mission of reaching people who are far from Christ. If you have your Bible, turn to James chapter 4, James chapter 4. In the New Testament. Now, church is a gathering of broken people. Put up your hand if you're a broken person. We are all broken people, including those who believe and those who don't believe and don't believe yet, or people who will never believe. Church is for everybody, for God so loved the world. And as ambassadors for God, we say our doors are open for our community, for everybody. Amen? The Bible is God's love letter to us, and we love him best when we seek to obey his teaching and make his teaching a priority. Our spiritual growth is accelerated, lifelong friendships cultivated, and community impact compounded in community groups and volunteering on service teams. It makes a difference when we actually act like the church. And whether you join us in person or online this morning, we invite you to connect in a community group. Make some new friends. If you're not connected, maybe you think about community groups in this way and this way. You know what? Give God the opportunity to change your mind about getting connected in a group. You will be blessed. I am looking forward to my group that is gathering this afternoon. Now, we celebrate every next step that you take in Jesus, and I just want to say congratulations, because you're going to take another step if you humble yourself to obey him and his word this week. Now, last week, James addressed what causes conflict and quarreling between Christians in church, and he boiled it down to pride, arrogance, and selfish desires within a person. Put up your hand if you have selfish desires in your heart. Every hand should be going up, right? We all can have selfish desires. And in our passage today, James begins giving another solution to conflict, starting in verse 11, but I actually want to start in verse 10, which is so powerful to think about this morning. Verse 10 says, "Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers. The one who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge." But James says this, "There is only one lawgiver and one judge, the ultimate judge, he who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you to judge your neighbor?" Verse 13, "Come now, you who say, 'Today or tomorrow, we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit.' Yet you don't know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him, it is sin. It is sin. In the sermon notes, the first point, number one, is that in your judgment of others, because we all have judgment. I mean, over the last 60 weeks, we have all had judgment about what's going on in our world, in our country, in our state, in our community. We all have judgment of others. In your judgment of others, don't play God. Don't play God. Let's relook at the first couple verses. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers. The one who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is only, how many? One. There's only one lawgiver and judge, he who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you to judge your neighbor? So James is talking about a couple concepts here with regards to speaking evil towards others. He's talking about slander. Everybody say slander. He's talking about slander, which is false accusations. It's projecting motives upon someone when only God knows true motives. And then he's talking about condemnation. So it's slander and condemnation. James is not saying we don't confront people about their sin. He's not saying that, clearly. James himself, in fact, is quite forward with regards to confronting his own readers and us today about our sin. See, people who don't understand the Bible and what it teaches quickly say, and I hear this often, well, aren't you not supposed to judge? Judge not. They might be thinking of the verse in Matthew 7:1 where Jesus said, judge not that you be not judged. That is a scripture verse. But listen, you should never create a conviction based on one verse taken out of context in scripture. For example, what's your opinion if someone told you that they heard me say this about someone eating lunch today? Hey, look at that jerk. I mean, isn't he a pastor? I can't believe he talked like that. I can't believe he called that person a jerk. But here's the problem. You didn't hear the whole context. You didn't hear the rest of the sentence. And you shared it with somebody else, and you spoke evil of me. So let me share the entire sentence. Hey, look at that jerk. That jerk chicken meal from Jamaica is delicious. Jerk chicken is a style of chicken, and I'm telling you, it's delicious. If you keep reading Matthew chapter 7, Jesus explains what he means. He says you should judge others, but not before you're willing to humble yourself and judge your own life and conduct first. As in, be wise, cautious, and humble in how you judge. Don't be flippant and quick in your judgment. Chuck Swindoll says this. He says, the Bible targets self-serving, malicious judgment, while actually encouraging wise, righteous, and discerning judgment. The Bible does teach clearly that we should hold each other accountable and confront a brother or sister regarding their sin with the goal of building them up in Christ. Amen? And you can read about how to approach somebody. Jesus lays it out in Matthew chapter 18. I encourage you to read Matthew chapter 18, where Jesus talks about if you have something against someone else. Now, John 7:24, Jesus said this. He said, do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment. Chuck Swindoll said, James, as he wrote his letter, he isn't suggesting that we be gullible and permissive, letting people get away with everything. Remember, in his own letter, James confronts fellow Christians about their sins. But there's a difference between confrontation for the purpose of building up and condemnation for the purpose of tearing down. Now, a huge problem I see in our society today is we don't know how to have a confrontation. We don't know how to humble ourselves and disagree with each other. Would you agree with that? I mean, this is my problem, even as a parent. When, you know, I put my kids in soccer when they were little. I'm about to put my youngest, my six-year-old, into soccer this August. I'm curious to see how they're doing it. But it's just bizarre that they give every kid a trophy. Some people win at some things in life, and some people lose. And guess what? We are teaching our young people how not to process how to lose. And we're teaching them, be a sore loser. No, let's be happy and joyful losers. Let's be happy and joyful when someone confronts you about sin instead of getting so defensive that things escalate into highly emotional conflict and you just tear each other down. Now, there's a difference between confrontation for the purpose of building up and condemnation for the purpose of tearing down. Look at verse 11. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers. The one who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks evil against the law and judges the law. Well, what law is James referring to? Perhaps he's referring to, if you flip back over to chapter 2 in James, go over to chapter 2, because this is important. Perhaps he's referring to the royal law that he talked about in chapter 2, verse 8. Look at verse 8. It says, if you really fulfill the royal law, which is the law of Christ, according to the scripture, and this is the royal law, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You are doing well. Everybody say love. That is the royal law. So when you confront to build up, that is fulfilling the royal law. And James confronted his readers to build them up when he called them, you adulterous people. He did that in love. But if you condemn for the purpose of tearing someone down, if you slander, and again, slander is to spread false, evil information about someone to damage their reputation. That is evil, and it breaks the royal law. And James just said in verse 7 of this chapter, to resist the devil. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Well, think about that term, devil. It's diabolos in the Greek, which literally means slanderer. Slanderer. The devil is a liar and false accuser. Spreading false information about someone to damage their reputation is acting in the way of the diabolos, of the devil himself. And it's also playing God, which is what the devil tries to do unsuccessfully. Chuck Swindoll says, only God can pass judgment on a person's actions and motives without fault, without hypocrisy, and without spite. Look at verse 12. There is only one, everybody say one. There is only one lawgiver and judge. He who is able to save and to destroy. The one who is all powerful, in other words. But who are you to judge your neighbor? James reminds us in verse 12 that there is only one God. There is only one God, and that is not you. That is not me. There's only one God who is the ultimate lawgiver and judge. By saying, but who are you to judge your neighbor? James is saying, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Who made you God? That's what he's saying here. See, there is a time to judge someone for the purpose of confrontation, to build someone up, and to protect the safety of others. Absolutely. But remember, even James himself, in this very passage, is passing judgment in love on his readers. How is he passing judgment right now? Well, James is passing judgment on his readers who are not motivated to love when they judge others. So James is passing judgment on how we judge. Well, let me ask you this question. How have you been judged lately? Have you been judged lately? I'm sure you have. In the past 24 hours, has someone judged you? Have you felt judged by somebody? In the past 7 days, have you been judged? Have you felt judged by someone? In the past year, have you felt judged by someone? Have you been judged by someone? And when you felt judged, did you consider, did you have this conversation internally? You know, was I just judged in this moment in love to be built up? Or was I just judged to be condemned and torn down? Like, have you honestly wrestled with that? I mean, we probably don't have this internal dialogue quick enough. I mean, we just have a knee-jerk response, at least emotionally, when we're judged. But listen to this. Not all judgment is the same. And if you think it is, you are elevating your opinion over what is found in Scripture. Let me say that again, because this is important. Not all judgment is the same. And if you think it is, you are elevating your opinion over what is found in God's authoritative word. So be very careful how you judge another's judgment. Take care to not allow your emotions to blind you to what kind of judgment is coming your way. You just might be judged in a loving manner to be built up by someone who deeply, deeply cares about you. See, a true friend doesn't always say what you want to hear. A true friend will speak the truth in love, which might feel like condemnation, but it's love if you take enough time to humble yourself and think and pray about it and process. But you can be, and I can be, so caught up in our own pride, defensiveness, and selfish desires that you conclude that every judgment coming your way is one of condemnation to tear you down. And that's wrong. And we all need to humble ourselves before a holy and mighty God. He's the one true judge, and he will figure all this out. Maybe you feel a little condemned in the loving judgment. How do you figure that out? Well, God will figure it out. Trust him. Take the gold out of the judgment of what God's wanting to teach you. Throw away the dirt and take the gold and honor the Lord in any relationship, in every judgment that comes your way. And listen, be quick to forgive the one you judge, and be quick to forgive the one judging you. Don't put up your hand, but are you quick to forgiving others in that scenario? I bet we all have work to do. See, that is keeping, quick to forgive is keeping in alignment with the royal law of loving your neighbor. Ultimately, it is God who knows the motives and will judge with perfect justice and grace and love, grace upon grace. So don't play God by slandering others based on assuming you know their motives. You don't even know your own motives sometime, right? We're messed up. We all are sinners. So be patient with others. Be patient with yourself. Love and humble yourself before Almighty God. In your judgment of others, don't play God, but honor God. Can I get an amen? Amen. Number two, continuing this theme of judgment, James continues, in judging your own life, because we all do this, we judge ourselves. Sometimes you're a brutal judge to yourself. I bet more often you judge to condemn, to tear yourself down instead of to build yourself up. Ooh, think on that this week. Pray on that this week. Really think about the judgment you judge yourself with. Do you play God when you judge your own life? Many people acknowledge God's sovereignty over certain tasks in life while keeping the more common tasks for their own quote-unquote sovereignty. Chuck Swindoll says this. He says, God becomes the boss of religious issues, moral matters, international conflicts, questions of faith, but we'll handle things like finances, relationships, and business decisions. I got this. I got this, is what we say to ourselves. We think God isn't as concerned about that kind of stuff. So we push God to the periphery and place our personal sovereignty front and center. Yes, we do have free will. God has blessed us with free will. But that doesn't mean that God is not ultimately in control. At any time, God can direct your path. He can open and close doors. He can nudge you this way or that way. He can allow you to make decisions in a particular circumstance over a particular amount of time, and that's up to him. He's God. Amen. What we do know is that all God does is good. He's a good, gracious, loving, compassionate God. And he is always in ultimate control of our lives. In God's sovereignty, he chooses to give you free will to make choices in this life. You are not a robot. He doesn't force you even to love him. He gives you the free will to reject him. He gives you the free will to choose evil against him and other people. But in the end, God will make all things right. There's hope in that. He will make all things right in his perfect, gracious justice. And you and I will give an account for our free will choices. And our hearts might choose to believe the lie that we have the ultimate control over all some choices in our lives. Pride falsely believes that we have this kind of control. Look in verse 13. Verse 13. It says, come now, you who say, today or tomorrow, we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Now, pastor and author and Bible scholar John Piper, he tore this verse apart, I thought, in a beautiful way that I want to share with you. He talks about in this verse is a presumption of control. We presume that we have control in so many areas of our lives. There's a presumption of control that we control time, today or tomorrow. That we control movement, we will go. That we control destinations, well, we will go to such and such a town. That we control duration. What does it say? How long are we gonna spend there? We're gonna spend a year there because we control duration. We have that presumption of control. Or that we can control activity and we will do what? We will trade, we will do business. And that we can control outcomes. Not only will we trade, but we will trade successfully and make a profit. Do you know what all this presumption is? What is all this presumption? Well, James tells us in verse 16, it is your boasting in your arrogance. It is my boasting in my arrogance. You act like you know it, and you control it. You act like you know it, and you control it. You presume with your head and communicate with your mouth that you know it and control it, yet here is the reality in verse 14. Look at verse 14. He says, yet you do not know. You do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? What is your life? You do not know or control. I do not know or control. And we don't truly understand what is life or even who is the Lord. So what is the nature of life? You are, but let's see if you can see this. Try not to get anybody wet in the splash zone. Come on, here we go. It was working before, maybe. Oh, there we go. Can you see that? Can you see that? I'm having a little bit of a malfunction here. There's water. I'm going to get wet. Look at that. You are, what does the scripture say? We are a mist. Gosh, what is a mist? Well, this mist isn't working too well. I'll put that away before I completely get drenched. For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then what? Vanishes. I mean, think back. What are the names of your parents? Okay, you know that. What are the names of your grandparents? You probably know that. What are the names of your great-grandparents? Put up your hand if you know the name of your great-grandparents. Put up your hand, great-grandparents. Okay, what are the names of your great-great-grandparents? Put up your hand if you know the name of your great-great-grandparents. There's less hands. What are the names of your great-great-great-grandparents? Put up your hands if you know. Some of you do. Some of you have done your research on your family history. You will be forgotten. I will be forgotten. You know, during the 9/11 tragedy, I saw all these posters. We will never forget. That is so far from the truth. We will forget. There are bigger tragedies than 9/11 that we have forgotten. What's most important isn't that we are remembered by each other, but that we are remembered by our Lord and Savior. Amen? That's the most important thing. You are a mist for a little time. What are the characteristics of a mist? Well, it's short. It went away quick. It's fragile, right? I can push all that misty product anywhere I want really quick with my hands. And it's not in my control, though. How far can I really push it? How can I capture it? Not very well. You're not in control. You have no control in making that mist. It disappears when it disappears. It disappears fast, and you can't do anything about it. How many of you have ever seen your breath in sub-zero temperatures? You've been up in the mountains, been in a winter climate. Put up your hand if you've seen your breath. It's hilarious because I grew up seeing my breath. It was not a novelty. I didn't realize how much of a novelty it was till I moved to California. And all these Californians are like, I saw my breath. I'm like, and I put on my shoes today. I didn't understand it. But my kids, they're so excited when they see their breath when it goes down to, you know, 35 degrees. I'm like, big deal. But as you exhale, your warm breath forms a small puff of white vapor that lingers for a second and then vanishes, gone. That's life. That's life. Even a relatively long life flies by. Would you agree with that? People who are older often say, it feels like yesterday I was in high school. Put up your hand if it feels like yesterday that you were in high school. There's not as many hands as I thought. Some of you have been around a while. That's just what you told me. I'm not telling you that. I'm not slandering you. Empty nesters say this all the time to my wife Shanna and I. Appreciate your young children while you have them because you'll blink and they'll be gone. They'll be adults. Many of you have said that to me multiple times, and I appreciate that. Because we don't appreciate things enough. I remember as a young child, vividly, I have this memory. Maybe you have a similar memory. I remember as a young child thinking about life, thinking about people who are older than me. I remember thinking specifically that 16 years old was so old. I had that thought. And here's another thought I had. 25 is ancient. Ancient. And now I'm beyond ancient. It went so fast. James 4:14, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. God is sovereign. He is sovereign over the shortness and fragility of your life. Verse 15, instead you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. And Piper, he unpacks this in a beautiful way as well. He highlights two if-then statements that James makes. Two if-then, cause and effect statements. The first one is, if the Lord wills, then we live. If the Lord wills, then we live. The only reason you live and I live in this moment right now is because of the Lord's will. So the converse of that is also true. If the Lord doesn't will, then we don't live. You guys don't seem as comfortable with that. If the Lord doesn't will, then we don't live. How could the Lord ever will that I don't live? That's a great question to chew on. You need to trust his purpose for your life and the length of your days. Your life is totally in God's hands. It's the Lord's will that you have a beat in your heart and breath in your lungs. You are not your own. You were created and are sustained by God and for God, and you have a great purpose for your life by the will of the Lord. Can I get an amen? So quit judging yourself in a condemnation-type fashion. Quit playing God. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The second if-then statement. If the Lord wills, then we will do. If the Lord wills, then we will do. As in, we will go into such and such town if the Lord wills. We will trade. We will make a profit if the Lord wills. Conversely, if the Lord wills, then we will not do. It's not just our life that is in the hands of the Lord, but our activity is also in the hands of the Lord. If you do this, God's will is that you do this. If you don't do this, God's will is that you don't do this. Now, you're probably thinking about some things, which is great, and I hope you are. It's never God's will that you sin. That's clear in Scripture. And he gives you the freedom to reject him and to sin, but that's never his will in your life. This, what James is talking about, he's talking about areas of life and areas of your choice where choosing A or choosing B is not a sin. There's many choices like that in life. Like applying for a job or applying for a particular college, trust that God will open and close doors for you. Amen? If you wonder, oh, did I mess up in that interview and not get the job? Or is it God's will that I didn't get the job? Those are great questions to ask and chew on and pray about. And we need to self-reflect on situations like that. For example, did you properly prepare for that interview? And don't rely on yourself to answer that question, because we have stars in our eyes with regards to ourselves too often. We can put ourselves down too often. We can build ourselves up too often. And we don't have sober ideas about us and our excellence, and if it was excellent, we need to talk to other people. If you didn't prepare well, get better prepared and keep interviewing, keep applying, keep knocking on doors with this particular field, career field. But if you did properly prepare and you have knocked on 50 doors and the door has been slammed on you 50 times, maybe God is closing this door. Thank the Lord for closed doors. Amen. Thank the Lord for closed doors, because then you can focus on knocking on other doors. But he will teach you. And sometimes it's God's will for you to knock on closed doors. Why? Because he wants to teach you and refine you and grow you up. I believe God gives us all free will. I really believe that. But I also believe that God can break into our free will at will. God can break into our free will at will. I'm even uncomfortable with using the term break. It's like he has to make some effort to do it. He's God. Yeah, that's just for us to kind of understand it and get our heads around it. God can break into our free will at will. Whenever God does or doesn't break into our free will, God is good. Stay close to God and wisely self-reflect and get the advice of others around you to discern how best to move forward and couch everything in fervent prayer. See, there's nothing wrong with planning ahead. There's nothing wrong with setting a schedule, making business plans, and hoping for a great outcome with solid financial profits. Nothing wrong with that. But don't forget that God's will in all those daily and weekly activities should be the Christian's priority. Not your will, but God's will. The reality is that we don't know what will happen today, much less next week or next year. Life can change dramatically in a moment without us doing anything at all. A few years back, I had a friend who was just a fantastic worship leader, just a great guy, just an incredible guy to be around. Love the Lord. And he loved snowboarding. So we went up to Big Bear and went snowboarding. And he had an awesome day. Just incredible snow and just had so much fun until the one moment when he fell. Now, most snowboarders can tell you countless stories of when they wipe out and fall. I mean, that's just par for the course. If you're going to be a snowboarder, you're going to fall. But this particular moment when he fell, all the variables lined up with regards to the rate of speed, the height from which he fell, the angle his neck made impact, the lack of snow depth, and the rock underneath. All these variables aligned together in one quick moment. In the midst of an awesome day of fun. And he hasn't walked since. And he was paralyzed. And trying to figure that out in your head. Was that all on me or was that God's will? Ultimately, he's going to find that answer out in heaven one day. And maybe it was a little both. But ultimately, God's sovereign over his paralysis. God's sovereign over your struggle and your pain and mine. And that's an extreme example, maybe very unlikely to happen to any of us. Even what happened in Israel in a moment's notice, these teenagers are dead, being crushed by the crowd. But the point is, ultimately, you and I, we don't control our lives. God is in control. And we need to humbly acknowledge that in everything we plan to do. There is this statement that it's not completely theologically correct, but it kind of helps us process this a little bit. You need to work like it depends on you and pray like it depends on God. Okay? But I would say, don't work like it depends on you, because God has better standards than you. Don't work like it depends on you. Work like it depends on God and depend on him. James says in verse 15, instead you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. That phrase, ought to say, literally refers to you speaking and believing that the Lord is sovereign. Now, don't just say this phrase, if the Lord wills, so much that you make it flippant and therefore meaningless. You need to believe it. If the Lord wills. Don't make it a tag-on statement that you superstitiously add to every sentence and every conversation, and you're like this weird hyper-spiritual talker that you don't really believe it, but is more superstitious. No, believe it. Sincerely appreciate the fact that God governs all things. Some of you need to say that statement more often and more often out loud, even in the common everyday decisions. If the Lord wills, I will find my left shoe today. If the Lord wills, my kid will clean the bathroom without me having to ask him. If you don't believe this way, and if you don't talk this way, and you talk in the way of verse 13, that is boasting and arrogance, and that is evil. Why? Because it excludes submission to the Lord's will. In essence, it's playing God as you judge your own life. Verse 16, as it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. It's easy to believe in your own press when you start having success. That's why you must stay humble when the pride of life temptation comes over you. Humility isn't denying your strengths or keeping them hidden. That's not what humility is. We all have great strengths that God has bestowed upon us, and they should be maximized to honor God and bless others. It won't do you any good to deny those strengths. Humility is recognizing your dependence upon God. Amen? Humility is recognizing your complete dependence upon God. And after a great success in anything, recognize your dependence upon God. James ends with a final comment on what he just laid out for us here. And what did he lay out? Well, how to avoid conflict and quarrels in your relationships by not speaking slander against people and humbly acknowledging God's sovereign rule over your life. He says, now you know that those things are good. And if you don't do that which is good, you are sinning. Look at verse 17. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him, it is what? It is sin. Oh, you guys, sin. Let's try that again. If you fail to do it, it is?
Sin.
It's sin. Sin is real, and you are a sinner, and sometimes you sin as I do as well. And we need to get this message that God's given us today. Do the right thing. Tell your neighbor, do the right thing. We need to hear that. We know it, but why don't we do it? It's not enough to just avoid bad things in your life. You need to do the right things. You need to actively do right things. Be wary of the sin of omission in your life. If you don't do what God's word teaches, it's a sin of omission. Submit to God, resist the devil, draw near to God, confess your external and internal sins, repent, take your sins serious, humble yourself. Don't slander others, and remember your life is a short and fragile mist, and you ought to believe and say that God is sovereign over it. So that's just a summary of what James has taught us over the last couple weeks. When we stand in judgment and slander our brothers and sisters in Christ, we are playing God. When we plan our lives as if God were uninterested or uninvolved, we are playing God. And playing God, like playing with fire, you're going to get burned. If you don't break yourself in humility before God, you will break yourself against God. Thank God for the book of James that judges us in love. Thank God for those people you have in your life that judge you, that judge me. In love. Thank God that we can rest our hearts in the fact that God is on the throne, that God is almighty, all-knowing, all-present, and all-good in our lives. We are a mist, and with our short time left, we will live and move forward in life's activities if the Lord wills it. Next week, if the Lord wills it, we will gather on Mother's Day. And we will kick off a brand new series that I'm so excited about as a man to learn and be inspired of some incredible women in God's eternal word. There's amazing stories and amazing women of faith. And I can't wait to dive into it. Invite somebody. That is the Lord's will, that you are a messenger of the gospel. Take many of these as you dismiss today and challenge yourself to hand out more of these than you've ever handed out before, because there are people searching for hope in all the wrong places, and we want to introduce them to our sovereign God who sent Jesus to die on the cross for them. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. God, thank you that you invite us to come to you, and it's as easy as ABC. If we just humbly admit that we are sinners, that we are arrogant, that we can choose evil over good. God, help us to believe that Jesus did die on the cross for our sins, to break the power of sin in our lives so we would no longer be a slave to the effects of sin. Again, admit that we're sinners. We believe that Jesus died on the cross, and see, choose to follow Christ. Choose to humble ourselves. That's our free will to do so, to humble ourselves and follow Jesus as our Lord, our leader, and our Savior. Thank you for your word. in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. We're going to go into a time of offering. And I just want to point out Psalm 78:4. Psalm 78:4. As we go into a time of offering, and there's going to be plates going by in just a minute. You can also give online. You can give by mailing your gift into the office. Psalm 78:4, it says, we will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about his power and his mighty wonders. Our kids' choir is resuming regular rehearsals today. That's awesome. Praise the Lord. And they are starting with rehearsals outside here on the lawn. You'll probably see them when we dismiss. And I encourage you, as you walk by and you smile underneath your mask, pray for them. Pray for our children that we are called to steward and pass our faith on to. Pray for Stacy Stone, our kids' choir director, and her leadership team as they give inspirational leadership to the kids. Kids' choir is open to any child between kindergarten and eighth grade. And because you generously give, we have this ministry for kids to build friendships, to have fun, to learn and strengthen their skills, and most importantly, to grow in the Lord, and also to learn to lead us old fogies in worship. It's our church's opportunity to tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about his power, about his mighty deeds. And we get the blessing when our kids come and worship and lead us in worship. Let's pray and let's give generously to equip every generation to reach our relational world for Christ. God, we lift up our kids' choir to you and Stacy and her leadership team. Bless them, Lord. And I pray that you draw more kids into this incredible ministry where they learn to sing praises. May the lyrics that they sing not just be mouthed on their lips, but find their way into these children's hearts. That they would grow into a relationship with you and do mighty things in your name. Father, thank you for the opportunity to give. We give so that your hope can continue for generations to come, because we want to be remembered by you and we want generations to come to be remembered by you. And I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, we're going to finish out this wonderful morning with the hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be, which is just such an ultimate expression of, not my will, Lord, but yours be done. So would you stand and worship with me? Take my life and let to thee, take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise, let them flow in ceaseless praise. my love, my Lord, I pour. At thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee, ever only all for thee. Take my will and make it thine. It shall Amen, Lord. That's our prayer this morning. Not our will, but yours be done. And we just thank you for this time. And all God's people said, amen. And we want to give you special instructions on being dismissed this morning. We just ask that everyone will exit through this door and just maybe naturally socially distance so people can get out. And then we just ask that you go ahead and go to your car. Don't linger, because we're just trying to stay safe on our campus so we can continue to come back and gather. The Lord bless you, and we will see you back here next week, Lord willing.